This video is brought to you by MyWayTeaching.com.
So in this part, let us see what is central force. Central forces. See, we know that the time rate of change of angular momentum of a single particle about the origin is the rate of change of angular momentum about the origin is given by r cross f. We know this equation. The angular momentum of the particle is conserved if the torque, that is given by torque is equal to r cross f due to the force f on it, vanishes. This happens when either f is zero or when f is along r, isn't it? So we are interested in forces which satisfy the later condition, which means when force f is along r. Central forces satisfy this condition. A central force is always directed towards or away from a fixed point, that is along the position vector of the point of application of the force with respect to the fixed point. See, the central force, it always acts away from a fixed point. The magnitude of the central force F, it depends on that position vector r, the distance of the point of application of the force from the fixed force. It depends on the position vector r and the distance of that point of application of the force from the fixed point. So in motion under a central force, the angular momentum is always conserved. The two important results follow from this. What are those two important results means? The motion of a particle under the central force is always confined to a plane. Motion of this particles is confined to a plane under the central force. The position vector of the particle with respect to center of the force, that is fixed point, it has a constant aerial velocity. In other words, we can say the position vector sweeps out equal areas in equal times as the particle moves under the influence of central force. An immediate application of this above discussion can be made to the motion of a planet under the gravitational force of the sun, isn't it? See, for convenience, the sun may be taken to be heavy, that is at rest. That is, the sun is considered as a fixed point. The gravitational force of the sun on the planet is directed towards the sun. Isn't it? This force also satisfies the requirement, that is F is equal to FR. Since F is equal to gm1 m2 by r square, where m1 and m2 are what? Yes, the masses of the planet and the sun, and g is the universal gravitational constant. So the two important results that we described just now apply to the motion of the planet. In fact, result 2, that is the position vector sweeps equal areas in equal times as the particle moves under the influence of the central force, is a well-known second law of Kepler, isn't it? We studied that law, Kepler law of areas. So let us solve a simple problem. Example 2. Three equal masses of m kg, each are fixed at the vortices of an equilateral triangle ABC. So the question is, what is the force acting on a mass 2m placed at the centroid G of the triangle. What is the force if the mass at the vertex A is double? Take AG is equal to BG is equal to CG is equal to 1 meter. So now we should find the force which is acting at the centroid, the first point, isn't it? And even we should find the force if the mass at the vertex A is doubled. So let us find the solution for this. So here we have considered three masses at M at the vertices of an equilateral triangle A, B and C. And even we should find the force at G. And they have given AG, BG, CG is equal to 1 meter, isn't it? Yes. The angle between GC and the positive x-axis, okay, is 30 degree, and so is the angle between GB and the negative x-axis, isn't it? That in an equilateral, since this is an equilateral triangle, the angle between GC and x-axis 30 degree, and similarly the angle between GB and the negative x-axis, if you consider the negative x-axis here, then this angle is also equal to 30 degrees Celsius, isn't it? So let us find the force on centroid due to the mass M at the vertex A, FGA. That is given by GM. The mass at the centroid is 2M, and AG square is given by 1, since AG is equal to 1, J cap. And similarly, we can consider FGB, which is equal to GM 2M by 1, the force at the centroid G due to the mass M at B. Okay, that is given by minus I cos 30 minus J sin 30. FGC is equal to GM 2M by 1, that is plus I cos 30 minus J sin 30. So from the principle of superposition and the law of vector addition, the resultant gravitational force is the vector addition of these three forces, isn't it? So FR is equal to FGA plus FGB, FGC. Okay. So FGA is, we can write it as 2G M square J cap plus FGB 2G M square minus I cos 30 minus J sin 30 plus 2G M square I cos 30 minus J sin 30. So this is equal to 0. Alternatively, one expects on the basis of symmetry that the resultant force ought to be 0. This is the solution for the first part of the question. So, coming to the second part, if mass at A is double, then the x component of the force cancels out and the y component survives. In that case, we can write Fr is equal to 4gm square j cap minus 2gm square j cap is equal to 2gm square j cap, isn't it? So, for the gravitational force between an extended object like the Earth and the point mass, the equation which we derived in the previous case, that is F is equal to gm1 m2 by r square, is not directly applicable. Because each point mass is in the extended object will exert a force on the given point mass and these forces will not all be in the same direction. So, we have to add up these forces vectorially for all the point masses in the extended object to get the total force. So, that is done using calculus. For the two special cases, a simple law results when you do that. That is, the first case is the force of attraction between a hollow spherical shell of uniform density and the point mass which is situated outside is just as if the entire mass of the shell is concentrated at the center of the shell. Okay. The force of attraction between a hollow spherical shell and of uniform density and a point mass which is situated with outside that shell, it's just like the entire mass is concentrated at the center of the shell. Gravitational forces caused by the various regions of the shell have components along the line joining the point mass to the center as well as along the direction perpendicular to this line. So, the components perpendicular to this line cancel out when summing over all the regions of the shell, leaving only the resultant force along the line joining the point to the center. So, there will be a forces towards the center as well as perpendicular forces. Those perpendicular components will be cancelled out. Only the resultant force is along the line joining the point to the center. So, the magnitude of this force works out to be as stated above. That is, the entire mass of the shell is assumed. Okay, it is concentrated at the center of the shell. Okay. Second is the force of attraction due to a hollow spherical shell of uniform density on a point mass situated inside is 0. So, we can understand this result qualitatively. Various regions of the spherical shell attract the point mass inside it in various directions. So, those forces cancel each other completely. So, there is no gravitational force of attraction, or we can say the force of attraction inside the spherical shell of uniform density because of the point mass which is situated inside. All the forces will get cancelled each other. So, the total force of attraction inside the spherical shell will be equal to 0. Okay. So, now let us see what is Newton's Principia. Kepler had formulated his third law by 1619. The announcement of the underlying universal law of gravitation came about 70 years later with the publication in 1687 of Newton's masterpiece, Philosophic Naturals Principia Mathematica. Often we call it as Principia. Okay. This is just in history. So around 1685, Edmund Halley, after whom the famous Halley Comet is named, came to visit Newton at Cambridge and asked him about the nature of the trajectory of a body moving under the influence of the inverse square law. So without hesitation, Newton replied that it had to be an ellipse and further that he had worked it out long ago, around 1665, when he was forced to retire to his farm house from Cambridge on account of a plague outbreak. Unfortunately, Newton had lost his papers. Halley prevailed upon Newton to produce his work. So Newton had lost his papers. Halley prevailed upon Newton to produce his work in book form and agreed to bear the cost of publication. So Newton accomplished this feat in 18 months of superhuman effort. The Principia is a singular scientific masterpiece, and in the words of language, it is the greatest production of the human mind. Okay. The Indian-born astrophysicist and the Nobel laureate S. Chandrasekhar spent 10 years writing a treatise on the Principia. His book, that is Newton's Principia for the common reader, brings into sharp focus the beauty, clarity, and breathtaking economy of Newton's methods.